Well, good morning. You know, I'd say let's rise and worship God, but the first song is Come Let Us Worship and Bow Down. So whatever you feel like, let's get up and sing. Come let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. Come let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, and the sheep of His hand, just the sheep of His hand. Let's sing that again. Come let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. Come let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. For He is our God, and He are the people of His pasture, and the sheep of His hand, just the sheep of His hand. And we'll continue with something that always gives me great comfort. If it just all seems like a bit much, God is the shield about you. Just open your eyes and see Him.
Thou, O Lord, are a shield about me. You're my glory. You're the lifter of my head. Thou, O Lord, are a shield about me. You're my glory. You're the lifter of my head. Hallelujah. 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 You're the lifter of my head. Hallelujah. 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 You're the lifter of my head.
You may be seated.
Well, good morning, my friends. We'd like to welcome you to our service this beautiful Sunday, August 8th of 2021. If you'll open your bulletins, we do have a few announcements today. Today, following our worship service, we do have our fellowship time in the fellowship hall. Come join us for some refreshments and some visiting together and just catching up with each other and getting to know one another better. And that'll be right after the service today in the fellowship hall. Sunday school classes will be starting on September 12th. Those will be following our fellowship time in the fellowship hall each week as well. And that's coming up on September 12th. So we're just a little more than a month away from starting our fall Sunday school classes. So make sure you participate in that. Pat's going to be leading the adult group, and we're so excited about what she's bringing to the table with regards to our Sunday school. And also, we're adding some technology stuff into the Sunday school time as well. So you're really going to be enjoying some changes in our Sunday school classes.
What about you and I. What about us? Aren't we teaching Sunday school?
Well, that's dependent upon student attendance.
Attendance. Well, that's important.
Attendance is important to have Sunday school. So make sure that you show up for Sunday school. Yeah, I'm looking at you. All right.
Because you know what? I've got a lot of fun things planned.
I know. Miss Kelly has lots of fun things planned for the children's Sunday school class, and I have the high schoolers and the junior hires in Sunday school as well. So we've got some good stuff coming up. So come participate in that. Coming up on Thursdays at 7 p.m. is our men's Bible study in the fellowship hall. Brad's been leading us through some of the Bible project stuff, and we're doing some good stuff in men's Bible study, so come participate in that. I do want to remind you that this coming Friday, August 13th, our parking lots will be reseal coated and striped and everything. So as of Thursday evening, the parking lots will not be available until Saturday again. So from Thursday evening to Saturday, mid-morning, mid-afternoon, something like that, the parking lots will not be available. Okay, they will have them banded off and closed off. So if you need to come to the church for any reason, make sure you park on the street. And let's see, other announcements. Carol and Mac have a new great-granddaughter, and so we want to just give them praise for that, and just are so grateful baby arrived safe and sound, and that they get to be great-grandparents once again. So I think that's all that I have for announcements. Are there any others? All right. I'll have Pastor Joy come up and share praise and worship with you.
Thank you, Roy. Praises and prayer requests for today. There's many printed in our bulletin. We do want to pray for Gibb and his family. His brother-in-law passed away last week, and so let's pray for his family and him during this time of transition, of mourning and grief, and celebration. A couple requests from Val that she has for Jody's mother, for Tanya's husband. I want to continue to pray for Vicki and her dad, that he's lonely and struggling with anxiety, and for Vicki for strength to do what she's wanting to do with and for him. Don's, I believe it's brother-in-law, Richard, was thrown from his horse and is in rehabilitation, so pray for him. And then for us, we have a bit of a transition. Slight, small transition coming for this next school year. Our little family is going to move to Meridian for the school year, for a year, so that our boys can attend Owyhee High School. It's the brand new school in West Ada District. So we'll be there during the school year, but still keeping the parsonage over here. So. Very grateful and thankful for the Moline's and their willingness to rent us their home while they're in Oregon. So all the doors opened up, and we're just thanking God for this time of transition that we're in. We do need to continue to pray for our country, for revival among the land and the world. Are there other prayer requests or praises we should know about?
Joy, my son-in-law had a seizure yesterday. Had to go to the hospital and get tested. I don't know the outcome. Same as here.
Okay. Is he still in the hospital then?
No, he's not still in the hospital.
Okay. And I've said, and I will continue to say, I hope throughout my entire life that there's one thing worse than not being able to hear little ones in worship service, and that is not having little ones to hear during worship service. So I am not distracted by Omari, just so you know. He can drop trucks and do little boom, and the rest of you might be, but man, I will just keep plowing ahead. So I am good, and I love hearing little card noises and things from kids in church. So let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, that we can come together, join together with one another, whether we're here in person, whether we're joining online with our family. Lord, I just thank you for spanning the miles from from here to Alaska for sure. Jesus, I just thank you for technology and what it's done for us as a church family. Lord, we do want to continue to pray for Gibbs' family with the death of his brother-in-law, for Jody's mom, for Tanya's husband. Lord, we do want to pray for Vicky's dad, for Richard, who's thrown from a horse. Lord, we do pray for peace and strength during this transition for my family, but we also praise you for just taking care of every single detail that has come up. God, that's what we prayed for, and you have answered, and we are walking through those doors that you are just leaving wide open for us. Lord, I thank you that we can join together, and we pray for Jerry, and we're so grateful that he was able to come home last night, but we do pray for him and the seizure that he had, for his medical team as they are going to be meeting and figuring out future things for Jerry, but just thank you for bringing him home last night. We continue to pray for Brooke and for her life and for just hope that she has for future. Some days are really dark and bleak, and God, I just pray that you continue to keep your hand upon her life. In your precious and holy name, amen.
Please rise. We'll continue in worship with "Create in Me a Clean Heart." Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. You know, you just, sometimes you need that renewal. Just take a deep breath, step back, and realize that God's got it. He'll renew that right spirit. We'll continue with "Have Thine Own Way, Lord." What you want isn't always what's best. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now, as in thy presence humbly I bow. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Wounded and weary, help me, I pray. Power, all power, surely is thine. Touch me and heal me, Savior divine. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Hold o'er my being absolute sway.
filled with thy spirit, till all shall see Christ only always living in me. That's a good prayer to have. You may be seated.
Thank you so much, worship team. We are going to have a short meeting, a gathering during our fellowship time of anyone who's interested in joining our worship team. I know Antonio has mentioned wanting to join and probably bring some changes because, you know, that's what youth do, and that's wonderful. So if you have any desire to join us, whether it's singing, if you play an instrument, we'd love for you to join us. I like how Kent doesn't make eye contact. It's almost like he's saying, don't make eye contact, don't make eye contact. We want to involve as many people as possible, and there's not a minimum age. Probably sixth grade, though, is where we would prefer you at least be in middle school. So you're welcome to join us on our praise team and just come to this informational meeting. If you're just even a slight bit interested, Pat would like to talk with us. So all right. What's our one takeaway from last week? The one that I said, if you can only remember one thing, remember this. And then it was like three things. Do you guys remember what it was? The one thing. All right, go ahead, help him out. God sees you, God loves you, and God's got your back. That was our takeaway from Obadiah. Was he's there with you. He sees every level of pain that we're in. He loves us. He's there with us. And he is fighting for us. He's got our back. So why do we study the minor prophets? We learn about the nature of God. We learn about the workings of God. That's why we study the minor prophets. Someone said that they avoided the minor prophets because they're too brutal. And I am finding where the minor prophets can definitely appear brutal. And yet, I'm also finding in them continual reminders of God's mercy and God's forgiveness for all who repent. And while the minor prophets may be brutal, I want to invite you to join me as we face them, as we face these minor prophets, with courage and commitment. This is courage and commitment that Joel himself faced when a people who were far from enthused with his message. The people receiving Joel's message, they weren't excited, and they didn't like the message that Joel was giving. But that did not discourage Joel or sway him from sharing. So if you will turn with me in your Bibles to Joel. Hopefully you read Joel this week, and this isn't your first run-through of this short book. So we're going to have two messages on Joel. So this is the intro and a little bit more. So Joel, the name Joel means Jehovah is God. So that's what his name means. We know very little about the author. This name, the name Joel, appears frequently throughout the Old Testament with at least a dozen men sharing the name. But this Joel, we have that he is the son of Pethuel. That's in verse 1:1. So there is no reason to associate him with another Joel mentioned in the Bible. So he is distinguished by who his father is. So at the very beginning, readers are overwhelmed with terrible cause of alarm. So that's us. When we are reading, the devastation was caused by this locust plague. And we don't really have locust here in that plague, but we've had grasshoppers. And I remember seeing grasshoppers like cover the road, or like they're so thick coming at you driving that you can't see. You're in a swarm of grasshoppers. So if you've seen that and you can picture that, magnify it by miles. And that's what this plague of locusts were. And the plague of locusts, this has some implications to show, yes, it's a physical plague, but also it gives this theological implication for their future, for where they are now, for where they've been. And so Joel is prophesying as a response to this dreadful plague. So he is seeing the locusts as God's judgment upon this apathetic Judah. And he sees that this plague is a stern warning of a more dreadful judgment coming for all who refuse to repent and renew their walk with the Lord. So Joel's purpose then is to reveal the plague against the backdrop of eternity by warning God's people to repent and prepare for an event far more catastrophic in scope. You know, we've experienced a plague now, haven't we? An epidemic, still going, not over. So for the first time in most of our lives, we've had things completely shut down. We're starting Bible study on Sundays, Sunday school, after a year off. We didn't have it last year. If we think about that, what if we thought about it in the way of God's warning people to repent and prepare for an event far more catastrophic in scope? I pulled out some key themes in Joel. So one is repentance and forgiveness. So there is a call throughout all of the minor prophets to repent and come back to God. And these minor prophets, their bullhorn call, the call that they gave was to repent and come back to God. Repent and come back to God. Another theme is eschatology. So that's the day of the Lord. It's a frequent theme in the minor prophets, especially in Joel. And the day of the Lord is referred to many times. And understanding the day of the Lord is important in understanding Joel. And we'll talk about those two this week. The next week, we see the theme of prophetic fulfillment. So the outpouring of God's Spirit was fulfilled at Pentecost. But Peter quoted Joel 2:28. And then also the theme of hope. So Joel points to a time where Jerusalem will never again be invaded. And he also points to a hope of all Christians that we have within us, that Christ is coming and has established his kingdom. So those are the four themes that I have found in Joel. So we've had this brief background now in Joel. We know who he is, kind of. We don't know very much about him. And then the call, why he's writing. And so we're going to read in Joel. These are very much, I'm excited to hear and have Pat and Roy take a couple of these minor prophets. As you know, I'm a more of a teaching preacher, so I take it, do outlines. I love learning about Hebrew meanings of words and Greek meanings of words, and that's a style of preaching. And then we have storytelling pastors, preachers, and Roy and Pat are more storytelling. And so I am really excited, and I hope you are as well, to have them preach on a couple of these minor prophets. It's good to get different styles, and that's important. So this is more teaching, and I've worked hard to figure out how to incorporate stories, but you know, these books are just about brutal enough that I don't know, we don't have a lot to compare it to. So really, we just don't. This isn't how maybe back in the tabernacle camp meeting times, it was more pulpit pounding and repent, the Lord is coming, you don't want to go to hell, accept Jesus. And I've been to a few of those, and I know that there's still preachers, and that's their style. I was not raised with that style of preaching, and that's not the style of preacher that I am, although I do believe that the Lord is coming, and we need to repent and accept Jesus. Okay, so Joel. We have this invasion of locusts. And so in verses 1 through 4, we have a graphic description of the locust plague. So the word of the Lord that came to Joel, son of Pethuel, "Hear this, you elders. Listen, all who live in the land. Has anything like this ever happened in your days or in the days of your ancestors? Tell it to your children, and let your children tell it to their children, and their children to the next generation. What the locust swarm has left, the great locusts have eaten. What the great locusts have left, the young locusts have eaten. What the young locusts have left, other locusts have eaten." And then we have this call to wake up and weep over the devastation. Verse 5 says, "Wake up, you drunkards, and weep. Wail, all you drinkers of wine, wail because of the new wine, for it has been snatched from your lips. A nation has invaded my land, a mighty army without number. It has the teeth of a lion, the fangs of a lioness. It has laid waste my vines and ruined my fig trees. It has stripped off their bark and thrown it away, leaving their branches white. Mourn like a virgin in sackcloth, grieving for her betrothed of her youth. Grain offerings and drink offerings are cut off from the house of the Lord. The priests are in mourning, those who minister before the Lord. The fields are ruined, the ground is dried up. The grain is destroyed, the new wine is dried up, the olive oil fails. Despair, you farmers, wail, you vine growers, grieve for the wheat and the barley, because the harvest of the field is destroyed. The vine is dried up, the fig tree is withered, the pomegranate, the palm, and the apple tree, all the trees of the field are dried up. Surely the people's joy is withered away." And then we have this plea to cry out to the Lord in verses 13. Put on sackcloth, you priests, and mourn. Wail, you who minister before the altar. Come, spend the night in sackcloth, you who minister before my God. For the grain offerings and drink offerings are withheld from the house of your God. And then there's this call to rededicate our lives. Verse 14, declare a holy fast. Call a sacred assembly. Summon the elders and all who live in the land to the house of the Lord your God and cry out to the Lord. Because, alas for that day, for the day of the Lord is near. It will come like destruction from the Almighty. And then in verses 16 through 20, it's this call to recognize their inability to survive without God. He says, has not the food been cut off before your very eyes? Joy and gladness from the house of our God? The seeds are shriveled beneath the clods. The storehouses are in ruins. The granaries have been broken down, for the grain has dried up. How the cattle moan. The herds mill about because they have no pasture. Even the flocks of sheep are suffering. To you, Lord, I call. For the fire has devoured the pastures in the wilderness, and the flames have burned up all the trees of the field. Even the wild animals pant for you. The streams of water have dried up, and the fire has devoured the pastures in the wilderness. Which takes us to chapter 2. And really, verse 1 is a cry to warn the people. It says, blow the trumpet in Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy hill. Let all who live in the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is close at hand. That means soon. Close at hand means soon. And in verses 2 through 11 of chapter 2, this day of the Lord, it's vividly described. It's dreadful, it's painful, it's frightening, and it's unstoppable. It is close at hand, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and blackness. Like dawn spreading across the mountains, a large and mighty army comes, such as never was in ancient times, nor ever will be in ages to come. Before them, fire devours. Behind them, a flame blazes. Before them, the land is like the Garden of Eden. Behind them, a desert waste. Nothing escapes them. They have the appearance of horses. They gallop along like cavalry. With a noise like that of chariots, they leap over the mountaintops like a crackling fire, consuming stubble, like a mighty army drawn up for battle. At the sight of them, nations are in anguish. Every face turns pale. They charge like warriors. They scale walls like soldiers. They all march in line, not swerving from their course. They do not jostle each other. Each marches straight ahead. They plunge through defenses without breaking ranks. They rush upon the city. They run along the wall. They climb into houses like thieves. They enter through the windows. Before them, the earth shakes. The heavens tremble. The sun and moon are darkened, and the stars no longer shine. Look at verse 11. The Lord thunders at the head of his army. His forces are beyond number, and mighty is the army that obeys his command. The day of the Lord is great. It is dreadful. Who can endure it? And then in verses 12 through 17, this call to prepare our hearts. Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. So through all of this, God gives us an opportunity. Return to me. Rend your heart and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. So verse 13 tells us right here that our heart is more important than public display. Rend your heart, not your garments. What matters is on the inside, not the outside. Who knows? He may turn and relent and leave behind a blessing, grain offerings and drink offerings for the Lord your God. And then verse 15, 16, and 17 is this call to consecrate themselves. Blow the trumpet in Zion, declare a holy fast, call a sacred assembly, gather the people, consecrate the assembly, bring together the elders, gather the children, those nursing at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her chamber. Let the priests who minister before the Lord weep between the portico and the altar. Let them say, spare your people, Lord. Do not make your inheritance an object of scorn, a byword among the nations. Why should they say among the peoples, where is their God? And then the Lord answers. And we see in verse 18 that he takes pity on them. Then the Lord was jealous for his land and took pity on his people. The Lord replied to them, I am sending you grain, new wine, and olive oil, enough to satisfy you fully. Never again will I make you an object of scorn to the nations. I will drive the northern horde from far from you, pushing it into a parched and barren land. Its eastern ranks will drown in the Dead Sea, and the western ranks in the Mediterranean Sea, and its stench will go up, its smell will rise. And in verses, surely he has done great things. Verses 21 through 27, we see God's provision. Do not be afraid, land of Judah. Be glad and rejoice. Surely the Lord has done great things. Do not be afraid, you wild animals, for the pastures in the wilderness are becoming green. The trees are bearing their fruit. The fig tree and the vineyard yield their riches. Be glad, people of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God, for he excuse me, for he has given you the autumn rains, because he is faithful. He sends you abundant showers, both autumn and spring rains, as before. The threshing floors will be filled with grain. The vats will overflow with new wine and oil. I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten, the great locust and the young locust, the other locusts and the locust swarm, my great army that I sent among you. You will have plenty to eat until you are full, and you will praise the name of the Lord your God, who has worked wonders for you. Never again will my people be shamed. Then you will know that I am in Israel, that I am the Lord your God, that there is no other. Never again will my people be shamed. And this ends the first part of Joel's prophecy. It's clearly pertained to the people of his day. And the rest of the book, it looks forward to a period described as afterwards. So verse 28 says, and afterward. And in those days at that time, and in that day. And so this section we'll tackle next week. But from what we've read so far, what lessons can we learn from Joel? Well, one, we can learn the value of natural calamities. So what can these do? Well, they can serve to turn people back to God. I believe we've seen that in the past 18 months. People are turning back to God. There is this element of unknown of how long am I here for, and what purpose is my life, and what do I want my life to mean, and what do I want to do, how do I want God to use me? So natural calamities can serve to turn people back to God. And God certainly used them throughout the Old Testament to reach out to his people and bring them back to him. So there's a spoiler alert for Amos 4. But not all calamities come from God. Some come from Satan. Remember Job. But whether calamities come from God or from Satan, or they're purely a coincidence, they should be times of reflection concerning our life and our relationship with God. So regardless of where the calamity is coming from, it should serve to point us back to reflect on where are we with God. Another lesson from Joel is the nature of true repentance. We've learned that it must be with our heart, that it must be inward and not just outward. It will show outward when it's inward, but what matters is our heart. We learn about the nature of God. We learn that He is gracious and merciful and slow to anger, and that He's kind. We've learned that He relents from doing harm when we repent. And we learn that the day of the Lord can be averted. The day of the Lord often refers to God's judgment upon a nation. And these judgments throughout the Old Testament were many. And they were often described in terms of the final judgment at the end of time. Think of the judgment of Babylon. And in the first part of Joel's prophecy, it referenced this plague of locusts that would be greater than what they had already experienced. But such judgments could be averted. Think of, spoiler alert for Jonah, think about the city of Nineveh. So such judgments can be averted. And when we compare Joel 1:11 and 2:1 and 2:13, verses 13 and 14 and 18 to 23, it appears to have been averted in Joel's day. And footnote here, this does not pertain to the ultimate day of the Lord at the end of time, but to these preliminary judgments that God often brings upon a nation. So these are nation judgments, not the final judgment. And so next week, we'll complete our survey of the book of Joel, and we'll find Joel writing about events that pointed to the beginning of the Christian dispensation, the Exodus. But before we close, I do want to remind you of a day of the Lord which is yet to come. And this is vividly described in 2 Peter 3. Verse 7 through 10. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and the destruction of the ungodly. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping His promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar, the elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. And this is a day, this day cannot be averted, but we can prepare for it. Verse 11, since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with His promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. So then, dear friends, since you are looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with Him. See, we can prepare for the coming of the Lord, and we can prepare for his return and help others prepare, keeping in mind that God is gracious and merciful, and he's slow to anger, and he's kind. But for those who continue to live in their sins, who know that what they're doing is sin, for those who know and continue, that's where Joel says in 1:15, "Alas for the day, for the day of the Lord is near. It will be like destruction from the Almighty." There's one thing in verse 13. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. That is something that we need to remember. Many of us, when we think about the end times, when we think about the final judgment, it makes us nervous and a little fearful, because it's so unknown, and the images used in Revelation are terrifying. They are. And so whenever I start to get nervous, or whenever I'm talking with somebody who really is nervous about it, we need to go back to verse 13, because this offers everything we need. Return to the Lord. That's what we have to do. We need to return. And then it tells us why. I mean, he is gracious. He's compassionate. He's slow to anger. He's not out with a whip to just keep us in line. And he relents from sending calamity. See, everything that happens, and we learned this when we did the story, the love story of God that we did in a year. It's God's love story to us, and it's to bring us back to him. So all these things that happen are happening to bring people back to him. And that's what we see here. It's God doesn't want to bring judgment and send people to hell. He doesn't. He wants to relent from sending calamity. He wants us to return to him. That is his full desire, is for us all to be with him in heaven for eternity. And we can have assurance. One of the questions I've grown up hearing is, if you were to die today, can you say with 100% assurance and confidence that you would be in heaven with Jesus? Because we can have that assurance, and we can say it with that confidence. I don't want to die today. I've got youngins, I've got grandkids, another one on the way. I want to stay here and live life with them and be a part of their lives. So I don't want to die. But I'm ready. And I know that if I died today, I will be in heaven with Jesus. And you can say that with the same confidence and peace that I have. It's available to all of us. These minor prophets, they just don't beat around the bush. And so there's no way to do a message from Joel without talking about the final judgment and salvation and returning to Jesus. And that's exactly what we should be doing every week, is bringing people back to Jesus. Can you join me in prayer? Lord, I thank you for giving us the book of Joel. I thank you because, one, it's a way that we can share the message of returning to you in words that we likely wouldn't use today. I thank you because it offers this view, this microscopic view into who you are. And God, we know you are compassionate. We know you are kind and that you're slow to anger. And we know that you do not want to send us for eternity to damnation, but you want us to be with you. We know that. And I thank you for that. And so, God, as we study your word, as we see what it was like then and what happened and how does it apply to us today, God, I pray that the one thing that we take away is our return to you. In your precious and holy name, amen.
Please rise. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Ooh. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. Ooh. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
You may be seated. Our benediction for today before we close our stream portion and go to open worship is from 2 Peter 3:17-18. Therefore, dear friends, since you have been forewarned, be on your guard so that you may not be carried away by the error of the lawless and fall from your secure position, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen. Thank you for joining us for our stream portion of our worship service today. Have a blessed week.